Many of you are still without your cameras turned on. Please turn them on. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Good evening, all of you. I didn't realize I was on mute. So, as I was asking, are there any doubts regarding the previous session? Yes, Manleen Kaur.
Yeah, ma'am, I have just one single doubt about double product. Could you just repeat that part? How do we add in
Double
double
product?
product? Yeah.
Sure. So for the double product, it's nothing much. It's just you just have to do the product thing twice. So this was the example that last class we used. So if I switch on my equation editor, this is the reason why I'm saying that in case you're using the equation editor, your speed should be really good because it's a very common thing that these glitches happen in Word, where the equation editor doesn't take certain inputs at times. And I also told you that the other solution here is that in case you are faced with such a problem during the exam, then you can always use the ribbon on top. So, we will choose the product sign from here. Now, here, let's say I write 100 and k is equal to 1. Then, over here, when I go on to the next box for the inside part, I will again insert a product. So, what happened here was that inside the product, I was supposed to insert the function. Instead of inserting a function, I'm inserting another product. So, here again, I will write my new limits. And then my function. Is it clear how we use the double product?
Yeah, ma'am, that's pretty clear, but there is one simple issue which I face every time is whenever I put like hash lambda, so it doesn't takes up, like not once, after 3 to 4 times it takes up. But after, like,
Yes,
suppose I've
that's
written
what
x,
I'm saying.
like when I add x hash bar or backslash bar, so it takes up. In the very first initial go, it doesn't takes up.
Yes, that's what I'm saying, that this is a problem which is just a glitch. There is no solution to it as such. You just have to keep trying.
Okay.
Sometimes it's honestly based a lot on your luck also. That is the reason why both the institutes, both IAI and IFOA, they say that if you are comfortable, then you use the standard keyboard notations because there is no option of messing up regarding the technical part of it. So today we will be dealing with the keyboard notations. So I would suggest that most of you should try using these keyboard notations. But maybe for some people, it might so happen that keyboard notations, when you use them, then they won't come in the form of symbols and the way you write it. So it might get a little intimidating at times when there are huge equations. Then it might so happen that you're not being able to understand what you yourself have written in the previous step. So those sums, maybe you can use the equation editor. But for the rest of it, I would suggest that use keyboard notations and try to get yourself accustomed to the keyboard notations because last term, which was the September 21 term, what they did was even the question in the question paper, what they did was they gave the questions in the form of these keyboard notations. For example, in the CS2 paper, Suppose we wanted to what when we are doing copulas, just a second. When we do copulas, we write C, and in the subscript there is UV. What they did was C underscore UV, which is actually the keyboard notation typing. And it was not just for copulas, even for the complicated time series sums, they used keyboard notations instead of actual symbols. So this is why it is necessary, even if you're not using it to type your answers, then at least you should understand them and be able to interpret them properly. Okay. So I hope all of you, I would say, given your 100% attention today, because it is a little complicated, but you, with practice, you will get used to it. All right. Any other doubts from last class? No, so we'll continue. What we are going to do today is, first we are going through the IFOA handbook, the examination handbook, where they have given the standard notations and the notations that we can use in our examinations. And then to practice them, we will be writing the same equations that we wrote last class using the equation editor. So the very basic ones for multiplication, obviously, the asterisk and division, the forward slash. These two are very standard things that we've always been using. For inequalities, you can simply use greater than equal to and less than equal to. For proportional to, you just write is proportional to. You do not have to make use of any symbols. You can simply write it in words, proportional to. And this is something that is true for most of the sums or most of the equations that you will be writing. For example, we'll see further that if you're integrating, you can actually write integrating over a to b in words. Just like when you say it, you can type it. So that is also an option. For square root, you simply write sqrt, and then within the bracket you write the function which is inside the square root, or the expression that is within the square root. For superscript and subscript, like we used it in the equation editor, we use the upward hat for superscript and the underscore for subscript. Here also we will use these, but what is the difference? That in the equation editor mode, it was getting changed to a superscript or a subscript. Here it will not get changed to a superscript or subscript, but it will be in the raw form. That is, if you have used an upward hat, then that will show in your answer script. So for superscript and subscript, what I would say suggest is that we did a shortcut last class, that for superscript it is control plus, and for subscript it is control equal to. So since you're writing the you're using the keyboard in the non-equation editor mode, you can easily use these shortcuts for your superscripts and subscripts instead of the upward hat or the underscore. But that is completely up to you again. For exponential, again, we have two options. One is the way we write it in our handwritten answers. We use exp and then within the bracket, we write the expression. Or like the superscript, you can use the upward hat. For accented symbols, that means, for example, if you're writing lambda hat or using x bar or any of the sums for estimators, etc., you can simply write b hat, or you can use an upward arrow, upward hat for it, because this upward arrow or upward hat actually signifies that the next thing is on top of the letter. So if you're writing x upward arrow bar, then it means that there is a bar on top of x. That is the reason for the arrow. But there is no need to complicate things. You can simply let go of that symbol. You can simply just write x bar. Now for Greek letters, they have been a little kind, and they have given the option of using English letters instead. But this is only for the very, very common Greek letters. You cannot use it for any and every Greek letter. Mainly it is for alpha, beta, lambda, delta, gamma. Maybe you can, but I would say avoid it. So these are mainly the common sigma. But sigma also, since S is already used so many times, I would suggest use the letters use the word sigma only instead of using an S. But for alpha, you can easily use A. Beta is B. Gamma is G. Mu, you can use M. But again, mu is just a two-letter word, so you can avoid it. Lambda, you can always use L for lambda. And the other thing is that there are also some capital Greek letters. For example, if you are doing a sum or normal distribution, then you can then you will be requiring the capital phi with the two lines on top and bottom. So in that case, whenever there are capital Greek letters involved, then you have to write the entire name of the Greek letter in capital. Don't think that when we were using the equation editor, we just had to make the first letter in uppercase. But if you are using standard keyboard and you're using those notations, then the entire word has to be in capital. And I will tell you why. Because in case delta, you're trying to write something like delta is equal to 3. So here, if I just type delta, it automatically becomes a capital D. And in the middle of the exam, you might not realize that the D is becoming uppercase. And if the examiner would have known that a capital D means capital delta, which is a triangle, then you would have been penalized for it. So instead, what they did was, if it is a capital Greek letter, then your entire word should be in uppercase. And if it is a small Greek letter, then ideally the entire word should be in lowercase, but it's okay if only your first letter is uppercase. That is fine, because sometimes that does happen. If you're writing something after a full stop, or if you're writing something in a new line. So that is fine, but try to avoid that also. Next is symbols like infinity. Infinity, you can always use the shortcut of INF instead of writing the entire word. For derivatives, again, there are two ways of writing the derivatives. One is the f dash method, where the first derivative is f dash x, second derivative is f double dash x, or you can use the dy dx method again. So here, it's simply because, as we saw, that the division is replaced by the forward slash, we will just write dy forward slash dx. And in case it is a second derivative, then here is the example, d square f by dx square. So here again, for the squaring, you will have to use either the shortcut for superscript, or you can use the upward arrow or the hat for denoting the square portion. If you're using partial derivatives, which is delta y by delta x, then you can just mention in brackets, after writing dy dx, you can mention it in the brackets, partial. Again, for this, we will be doing an example, so you can see over them. For all the large operators, which is integration, summation, and product, these three, we have limits in them. So limits as in there is a lower limit and there is an upper limit. So how do we express those? There are 3 to 4 methods I would suggest. All of you have these 3-4 methods in front of you. Whichever one you feel you will be comfortable with, pick that one up. What I would suggest to all of you is using this method. Sum over A to B, writing the entire thing, will become a little cumbersome during the exam, because it's not just once that you're having to write it. There are multiple times that you have to write it. So that one is a little longer. It might waste your time. So I would say avoid it. The best way that I find is the first one, where you just write INT for integration, sigma or sum for the summation, and product for the capital pi or the product sign. And then in the bracket, just after writing this in the bracket, you will only mention first the lower limit and then the upper limit. So here, in all the three examples, A is the lower limit and B is the upper limit. So as you can see here, they have written INT, and in the brackets they've written A comma B, product A comma B, sigma A comma B, or sum A comma B. And then there is obviously a function which you have to integrate or sum over or multiply. So that function before writing that function, what are you doing? What are we integrating? So for that, we use a colon. As you can see over here, there are colons used, and then you write the function. Whatever you are integrating or whatever you are summing up. And the other method, in case this method some of you do not want to use, the other method which you can use is the, just a second, the other method is using the box brackets. So here what happens, instead of using the colon, before the colon everything is the same. Now instead of using the colon, you can simply put the expression or the function inside the box brackets. Clear? Now this other thing for integration, obviously there are two forms. One is the integration form and one is the solved integral form. So for the solved integral, obviously you will have to use the box brackets because that is how we use it in the symbolic form also. So you will write the expression or the function inside the box bracket, and then with a colon, you will write the limits. Okay, here we can see there's an example where ft is the expression inside and the limits are a and b. So they've written the function ft inside the box brackets, and then they have written the limits using colons. Clear? The statistical notations are comparatively easier because in statistics, we tend to use more of written letters only. And inside whatever there is, it is similar to the normal ones such as x square or maybe exponential, etc. So for expectation, obviously you can use just a capital E. For x given y, I would say that you don't need to use the word given. The line is on your keyboard itself. It's just above the enter button. The button which has your backward slash. If you use that button along with shift, you will get the straight line. So you can easily use that. I don't think it will be much of a hassle or it will require too much of efforts. So just go with it. For variance, obviously variance, covariance is just V and COV. For the distributions, mainly for chi-square, for the other distributions, usually for T, it is again just a subscript. For T distribution and for chi-square distribution, again chi-squared is already considered as one word, and then you can to write the degrees of freedom, you can use an underscore and write the degrees of freedom. This second option which they have given, chi-squared with m degrees of freedom, I would say avoid it because then again too many words, so writing it again and again does not make sense in the exam at all. The binomial coefficient or the combination function, the C function that we use, it is actually also called the choose function. That is the name. All of you, most of you must have done R over here, so you all know that it's the choose function, and it is written in this form also, in a bracket with N on the top and R on the, R in the bottom. So you can use either of the two because both requires equal amount of effort. N choose R, which is N C R. So N choose R you can write, or you can write choose and in the brackets you can write the two parameters, which is N and R. Okay, for the compound interest and life table annuity, we will go in depth when we will do the paper specific exam, because these are some things which are not required by all the papers, but the basics we will do right now. For example, IP. What does IP represent? It represents interest rate for a particular period. So it is IP. You do not have to make the P into the superscript. It is not required. Even if you simply write I and P in brackets, or same for D, which is the discount rate, D and in brackets, if you write P, it's fine. For delta, which is the continuously compounded discount rate, you can simply write delta. Do not use D over here. Because as I had said while discussing the Greek letters, I had said that instead of delta, you can use D. But when you're dealing with interest rates, then I would say write the entire word delta. Because if you're only writing D, they might consider it as a discount rate instead of continuously compounded rate. Correct? So always on the safer side, write delta full. Now these functions where you have the n inside the box. When the n is inside the box, to represent that box, we use these less than and greater than signs, meaning the n, which is the number of periods, you write it inside the less than and greater than brackets. Clear? For the life table functions, it's nothing. It's just like the division. You just use the forward slash for ly by lx normally, and for, same for dx by ly. Kpx, mqx, etc. It is just like you say it. You do not need to subscript the k and x. You can write it on the same line. This they have allowed. For a due, what you have to do for the two dots, you just have to write the word a due. You do not need to make any two dots in any form, or you don't think that if I'm using a colon, then that represents two dots. No, it does not. A colon is very different from the accents, the two dots on top of a. So you just write a due. Okay. Similarly, for a bar, you will write a bar. Don't write anything else. Just write a bar, and then whatever the other parameters are, whether it's x, n, p, I, whatever parameters you want to use, we will be solving the paper for CM. Mostly in CM1, you need this. For the others, you don't really require this much. So while solving that, we will get into the details of how different varieties of life table functions can be written, annuities and assurance especially. All right. So this is the gist of the standard functions and the standard keyboard notations that you will be requiring during your exams. Apart from this, two things that we two things that last class we did not use in the equation editor. One was matrices. Many of you must be thinking that how are we supposed to insert matrices in our answer script, and the other was the choose function, which we just saw. So for matrices and choose, actually I would suggest never use the equation editor. Never ever use the equation editor, because for the equation editor, it's very complicated, first of all. And even if you want, for up to a 3x3 matrix, you get it in the ribbon. I'll just show it to you. Here you have the matrices. So in case you want to write the choose function in its original form, you can use this 2x1 matrix. I'll just show. Let's say I'm trying to write 4C3. So I will write a 4 and a 3. And I will enclose this in the normal bracket. Since in the choose function, we always use the normal bracket. We never use box brackets for choose function, right? This is how the choose function looks like. And similarly for the matrices, what you can do is up to a 3x3 matrix, you can see over here that we have an option of choosing the empty matrix and then inserting it. But beyond a 3x3 matrix, if you want to insert, the easiest way is by inserting tables. So let's say I want to insert a 4x4 matrix. So I will insert, go to the insert tab, and I will insert a 4x4 table, right? Because I need a 4x4 matrix. I will insert the 4x4 table and simply put in my elements. You can put in all kinds of elements inside the table. In case you are working with variables, you can easily type the letters. Or if you're working with numbers or negative numbers, you can use the everything is allowed inside the table, correct? So you can put matrices using the tables. And I would suggest that you keep this only as the standard practice. Don't get into, even if you search on YouTube, obviously you will find the equation editor shortcut, but that is already very complicated. So no point getting into it. This is a much better representation. It is easier also. One thing, in case you insert a 4x4 matrix, 4x4 table, and you realize while entering the data that you needed one more row, let's say. Let's say you needed one more row. So one way of inserting that row, I will just put in some dummy elements once. So let's say I inserted these 16 elements and then I realized I need another row. So how do I get another row? Will I go and will I insert a fresh table? Not at all. Don't even think of it. There is a very simple way. Once you reach the last cell of a table, and if you want to add another row, you can simply press tab. As soon as you press tab, the table automatically a fresh row will be added to your table. Now suppose you want to insert a column instead. So you cannot press tab and do it, but it's as easy. You just have to right click and you get the option of inserting. So when you click on insert, you will get four options. Insert cells usually you do not require. You usually require insert rows and columns. So now there are four options. You can either insert columns to the left or the right, or you can insert rows above the current row or below the current row. So let's say I had missed a row in my matrix after the second row, meaning there was a row in the middle which I missed. So I will come to my five, let's say. I will right click and I will insert rows below. Okay, so as you can see, now I have a fresh row in the middle, so I can put in my elements now easily. Another thing, how do you navigate inside the table? For moving ahead, you can press tab. By pressing tab, you will move cell to cell. First, left to right, one row. Then the next tab will take you to the next row. Again, left to right. This is how the tab button works. Now, suppose if you want to navigate in some other direction, you can always use the arrows on your keyboard. The upward arrow, downward arrow for moving up, down. And for the left and right navigation, either you use tab or you use the left and right arrows. Again, this you will get used to when you practice. Right now, just by listening, you cannot remember so many things. So I would suggest that today all of you try inserting a table and navigating it and knowing, getting comfortable with how it works. All right. So that is about matrices. Now it might so happen, for example, for CS2 students, the rows and the columns, they also have headings, right? So what you can do over here, you insert an extra row and an extra column, and that extra row and column will be for headings. So if I wanted a 2x2 matrix, instead I will insert a 3x3 table. So A, B, suppose this was my, these were my column and row headings. And now inside I can fill in my data in these four cells. Yeah. So this way you can even insert your headings as well as you can insert your elements. If you would have used the equation editor, then your headings would have given you a major headache, right? Is everything clear up to here? Then we will move on to practicing the equations again in this mode.
Ma'am, can you just repeat the navigating area once?
Navigating area, sure. So first, let me insert a table. For navigating, you want to navigate from cell to cell. Let's say if I'm entering data right now, I entered 9. I want to move on to the next cell. So either I can use my left or right arrow, or I can use tab. The tab button moves cell to cell from left to right. And then when one row is over, it moves on to the next row. Again, it goes left to right and this continues. And if you move or if you reach to the end of the table, let's say right now I'm at the end of the table. If I again press tab, then another fresh row will come in my table automatically without me having to insert it. Just by pressing the button, I will get a fresh row. If I want to navigate up and down, I will just use the up and down arrows. Same goes for navigating towards the left, because the tab button moves towards the right. For left navigation, we have to use the left arrow only. Clear? So right now I'm here. If I press the left arrow, I move to the previous cell. All right.
Okay, ma'am.
Anything else? Everything is clear up to here? Yes, Manleen.
Ma'am, just a general thing, like suppose in a question, some part initially we did it using an equation editor, and in some parts in order
Yes.
to save time I'm using keyboard. So is it okay, or we need to be consistent with one way?
I would suggest that be consistent, but then
Okay.
again, maybe if one, two questions you want to change your method, then it's fine. I mean, they won't really penalize you for it, but it doesn't give a good impression on the examiner. That is the only reason. All right. Just give me a
All
second,
right.
I'll just get the charger. All right, so no more doubts. Ma'am, is the I will have to check whether it's uploaded or not. I will ask one of the other team members to get back to you. All right. So let's start practicing the previous class equations in this mode. So as you can see, I've already written them once. I will type them again along with you all. So for this one is a square root example. So as I had said, we will simply write SQRT, and then inside the bracket we will write the expression that is under the square root. So x square. Now instead of this x square, what you could have done was x and then simply pressed Control Shift equal to. So that would have taken you to the superscript. Again, I'm reminding you, don't forget to come back to normal. So again, Control Shift plus, and I'm back to normal. Plus alpha by x. Alpha, you can use A, you can type alpha, both ways are allowed. So let's use A since I've already written alpha once. Let's use A by x. Again, for minus beta, you can either write beta or you can just write a b. Both are equally acceptable. All right. For limit, they haven't really mentioned anything. They haven't given us any form. So, going by the other example, we will write limit. You can use LIM or LT if you want, but LIM is usually more acceptable. So, use LIM. In the bracket, we will write x to infinity, which is basically whatever is below the limit. What I would suggest is you can use an underscore over here. Before writing this, you can use an underscore. It is not necessary, but it is better if you will use the underscore before writing the below portion. A to the power x, again, control shift equal to a to the power x, coming back to normal. For cube root, there are two ways. Either you use cube root CBRT, you write cube root, or the best way and the most convenient way is to make it to the power 1/3. As all of you must be knowing, a cube root is same as making the expression to the power 1/3. So I think let's go with that one. Oh, here I've written square root by mistake. What I'll do in this one, I will try to use the 1/3 method. So first, within the bracket, I will write x to the power 4 plus 1 to the power. Make sure you make use of brackets very, very, very well. Since there are small, small components of the function, try to use a bracket for each component. All right. To the power 1/3 minus 2x. Yes, Shay.
Ma'am, just like you are writing those formulas, just like we write it in copy, but when we will solve those sums, it will be, wouldn't it be very confusing, like so many alphabetical
Exactly what I said. Exactly what I said. That sometimes it, in fact, on a personal level also, even I find it very confusing to write it in this form. So if you are wanting to use the equation editor to avoid this from happening, you have to be really fast at your work. And you have to practice the other method as well, because sometimes what happens is when you're using the equation editor, that time your computer tends to slow down a little, your application. So that's why if you practice from today, your exams are in April, May, that time. So you can easily get the hang of it, because that is the only way. Now, when you entered into the field of actuaries, obviously so many letters and so much of algebra must have intimidated you. You must have thought that how will I work with so many of them? But with practice, you got used to it. So here also, this is just as if you are learning a new way of doing the sum. So if you practice it, I'm sure you will be good to go.
Ma'am, and one more thing, like when we are doing an Excel, we enter the question and it automatically gives us the right answer. But if we are doing it Word, means we have to use a calculator and we have to show each answer, right?
So it depends what topic you are doing. They have allowed us from the, I think, last two terms, the institutes have allowed us. I'm not very sure about IAI. About that, I will get back to you in the next class. But IFOA definitely has allowed us to use other softwares for our calculation. So for example, if you are using Excel to do any calculations, for example, profit testing, or let's say even if you are using it to find out the variance or covariance, then you can do that. It is allowed, but you have to ensure that in your Word file, when you're copying it, you have to explain what you have done. Meaning you have to write the formula. For example, let's say for profit testing, you made the entire table on Excel and you copy paste that table from Excel into your Word file. But you have to mention below the table each column or each cell's calculation, whatever addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, etc. you have done. It should be mentioned so that the examiner knows how you arrived at those values. Because when you're using it in Excel, the formula is inbuilt. The formula is inbuilt, so the examiner won't be able to see what formula you have used. They will only see the resulting values. So that is why if you're using Excel, obviously you are allowed, but make sure that you explain your working well. All right.
Now, for example, if I'm integrating on MS Word, like there's a function. So when I will put the upper limit and lower limit, I have to use a calculator behind me, like how means I have to enter the values and show the calculations in each step.
How will you integrate in MS Word?
Ma'am, we have to integrate, like we can enter upper limit and lower limit. Mm-hmm. And when we enter function, when we solve the integral, so how we will solve, like?
No, for the integral to solve, we don't use calculators to solve integrals. You arrive at the final thing, and then when you get the solved answer and you have to input the limits, that you can simply just write one step where the variable form of the integral is written in the box brackets and the upper and lower limits are mentioned. And then in the next step, you can straight away write the answer. So whether you are doing that on your calculator or whether you're doing that on Excel or using any other software, it does not matter. As long as you have showed your working up to the step of the variable integral along with the upper and lower limits. The fundamental principle is just that whatever you are doing should be transparent. All right. But whatever way you're using, it's fine. Whether you're using Excel or maybe some people might want to use R, but you have to explain what you have done. You have to show the examiner. Suppose even when we used to have written exams, we used to use our calculators. But if you do 3-4 steps on your calculator, let's say for linear interpolation, one of the biggest areas where you can get a mail maybe, or you can be caught for unfair means, they want us to write the formula for linear interpolation as well. So in case you are using, let's say for a normal distribution, if you have taken two values from the table book, and then you're interpolating between them, you have to mention both the values in your answer script and get into the habit of writing the entire formula for interpolation, which is the fx and x formula. Fx minus fx1 by fx2 minus fx1 is equal to x minus x1 by x2 minus x1. This entire formula you should be used to writing this or typing this in your answer scripts so that you're 100% transparent. Just remember that they are already making your life a little easier by holding the exams online. So these are the places where they are going to be a little strict.
Ma'am, how is our lives easy? Ma'am, it is becoming more difficult. In offline exam, we can write very fast.
That's what I'm saying. Everything has its pros and its cons. Here you're getting to give an open book exam. That would not have been possible if you're giving it writing or offline.
Ma'am, but you know the CA Institute is conducting offline exams even though there are so many CA aspirants in this IFO.
I know. I have gone offline and given the CA exam. I know it. I have given the online actuaries exam also. I've given the offline CA exam also. But trust me, both have their own pros and cons. Right? For a CA student also, they would have loved it if they would have been allowed to give it online because there are so many things to remember, etc. So obviously, they are crying that we are not getting to give it online. And here, the actuary students are crying because they have to type so much. But trust me, you have 3 months from now. 3 months, if you practice all your sums on MS Word, or even if you practice 40% of your sums on MS Word, you will be good to go. I am telling you this from my personal experience that it is not difficult. If you practice well, it is not difficult at all. So many people, there have been four terms of online examinations, and everyone's given the exam. No one has faced any problem as such. Obviously, your speed matters a lot over here, and that the only solution is practice. All right. Anything else, anyone? We'll continue. Next. So now is the partial differentiation, partial derivative. As I had said, here you write dy dx and then you mention partial. All right. Or also what you can do is you can write delta y by delta x. That is also a method, but I would suggest this is easier. You simply use this x square, or let's try using this x square plus exponential of x plus 4. All right. Integration. Again, there were multiple options for writing the integration sums, but these are the two options which I would suggest that you all use, either of the two, because the rest of them, they are very time consuming. For infinity, we can simply use INF. So it's minus INF to INF. After writing the limits, now we will write the function that has to be integrated. So it's x exponential, or you can also put in an asterisk over here. And then the dx. And the other method is, instead of using the colon, you can use the box brackets. So I'll just copy this from here. Control V dx. All right. For the summation, again, as I said, these two should be the methods, which should be your choice. For sum, summation, you can either use sigma or you can use sum. Both words are acceptable, but ensure that at least you're using a capital S sigma, even if not full sigma in capital, because as you all know, this sign is the capital sigma sign. The small sigma is this, and the capital sigma is the summation symbol. So to be safe, I would say always use some. Either use the colon or use the box brackets. Product again, same thing. Product limits 1, 100. Then again for the second product, again first I will be writing the limits. And then you use the colon to write your function. For proportional to, you cannot use any symbol over here. You simply have to write it in words. Now, instead of lambda, as I said, you are allowed to use an L, or if you want to be safe, you can type the entire word, or if your speed is good enough. But both are equally acceptable. For adu xn, we write the word adu colon x colon n. Now n, here the n is not inside the box, but if it was inside the box, then we would have to write it between the less than and greater than signs, right? Here, as you can see, I have used so many brackets because there are so many different components of the expression. So be sure that when you're typing, after typing each line, or maybe after typing two, three lines, check whether all your brackets that you have opened, you have closed those brackets, and there is nothing which is not making sense to you in your answer. In fact, I would say that I want to insert one bracket over here also to separate the entire portion before the multiplication sign. I would say use another bracket. It just makes your work better and clearer. Yes, Vedi.
Ma'am, in this one, can't we write it as adu, then underscore, and then in the brackets x and the straight line and then n?
No. No, this for the annuities and assurances, the institute has given strict, very specific notations. So I would suggest that you follow these only for your examinations. It makes sense. What you said does make sense. But since they have given only one option, if they would have accepted another option, then they would have mentioned it. But for example, for the others, they have given us multiple options. Here, they've only given one. So it's better if you stick to that. All right.
Okay, ma'am.
Now here, capital letters and small letters. There are both the thetas in this. So for the capital one, obviously I will have to write the entire word in caps lock. And for the small one, I will write it in lowercase. Similarly, for phi, normal distribution phi, I will use the uppercase to type it, since we need the capital phi. And here we go. For the hat, now the hats and the bars. As I had said, either you can simply write it or you can use the upper hat or arrow, whatever you call it. But it is redundant. It is not required. So you can let go of it. And you can use L instead of lambda. So let's type this. L hat is equal to X bar, which is equal to summing over. Now here, as you can see in this equation, I have not mentioned any limits, but I'm sure when you will be writing your examination, there will be some limits involved. There will be some limits involved. So let's say if I take an example over here, I goes from 1 to 10. And what am I summing over? I'm summing over xi. And then I will have to use another bracket to close the entire thing. because the sigma is only for xi, it is not for n. So to show that, I will have to use another bracket for separating the numerator and the denominator. Had I not, for example, here I've given the wrong one, so that I could show you all, if I'm writing this, then this can be interpreted as if the sum function is being applied over xi by n. But that is not the case. It is being applied only over xi. So make diligent use of brackets. All right. So any doubts, any of you?
Ma'am, can you please show the ADU one again?
Sure. The ADU one? Yeah. You type ADU, then you give a colon for the X parameter, another colon for the N parameter, and then you type the entire formula. Now, this formula is obviously a very complicated one. So as you can see, I've made use of too many brackets starting from here. So this is actually what you can think of it as is maybe when you're inputting it into your calculator. When you input it into your calculator, this is exactly the way you have to use your brackets, correct? Or what else can you do in your calculator? You go step by step. Maybe first you calculate only 1 plus r to the power n. You calculate that, then you put a 1 in the numerator and your answer in the denominator. So how can you do this? First, I'm calculating 1 plus r to the power n. So I typed in, just a second, it's on the subscript. 1 plus r to the power n. Then what do I want? I want a 1 in the numerator. So then I will divide this. I did it. Then what will I do? If I'm working on my calculator, I will do a 1 minus answer. So I will type 1 minus answer. After that, I will divide the entire thing by r, which means which is now my answer. I will divide it by r. So now I will divide it by r. And then what will I do? Now my new answer, I will multiply it with 1 by r. So I will just write multiply it with 1 by r. 1 plus r, I mean. Sorry. Clear?
Yes, ma'am. Got it. Thank you.
So this way, also, you guys can type it thinking in this way, that if you were working on your calculator, because if you imagine yourself inputting things into your calculator, it obviously gets easier because there also you use these many brackets, right? Anything else? Everything is clear up to you? Yes, Mehak?
Ma'am, can you please share the MS Word document for this class as well?
Yes, I think they will be uploaded in the drives, I guess. So I will ask them to do it as soon as possible. Anything else? One more thing which I want you all to remember is, don't try and act smart. The Institute has strictly mentioned that you cannot use saved equations while browsing, searching. Maybe you came across this feature that you can save equations on the equation editor. Yeah. There are some saved equations over here, the common ones, and you can add equations to this list. These are the built-in ones. You can add your personal equations, but the Institute has said a strict no that there cannot be any pre-filled equations used in your document. They can check it whether the equation which you have used is stored previously or whether you have typed it while giving the exam. So don't try to get yourself into trouble. No point at all. 1 minute versus 2 years. Because if they catch you, you will be banned probably for 2 years or something. So I think the decision is very clear, right? So that is one thing. Another thing, graphs. Graphs, there is a very, very low chance that they will ask you to make the graphs, but you have to know how to read the graphs, because they can easily give you a graph in the question paper and ask you questions based on it. And yeah, graphs, there is a very low chance, but in case you do want to insert a graph, either you can make use of Excel and for inserting the graph, or you can insert a chart from here as well. You can insert a chart from here as well, but I would suggest use Excel if required, even though it's very unlikely. For inserting the header and footer, the last class, as I had told you, you can go to the insert tab and insert the header, footer, even page number. If you all wish to, you can always put in the page number, not a requirement, but something that you can do to make your work better. What else? Yes, I think that's it. Anything else? Any questions in general also regarding the examination or the typing part of the examination?
Ma'am, during the exam, do we have to, you know, how does the institute checks whether we are doing any wrong mistake? Like, is there any video on or any sort of thing?
It depends which institute you are giving it from. IFOA does not have any proctoring of any sort. They just have a very strong software which catches you once you've submitted your answer script. IAI has a proctoring system. So for IAI, it is not really an open book exam. You are proctored, meaning there is an inbuilt camera and a microphone in the examination software. So full time, your mic will also be on. So in case there is any sound around you, then you will be flagged and the invigilator will be notified. Or if you're looking away from the camera for a very long time, then too, you will be flagged. So yes, for IAI, there is a system of invigilation. For IFOA, there is not. Anything else?
Ma'am. Ma'am, how is it possible to complete the paper within the time frame if you have to show like every step, you have to type every step?
No, it is not difficult. It is really not difficult. Sometimes, maybe, yes, but those sometimes are also present. When haven't you ever felt, when you've gone to write an exam, haven't you ever felt a paper is lengthy? Obviously, you have.
Exactly. Typing each and every step will make it more lengthy, right? Like, it's, I'm not saying it's difficult, but time. How will
So they obviously know that you are not writing answers, you are typing answers. So even if you compare different terms papers, if you compare offline versus online papers, you will see that the number of questions are reduced. For some papers, they give MCQ based so that you do not have to. For example, if there is a question, you think it's not just you, it's the examiner also who has to go through the torture of actually understanding each and checking whether each bracket is given, whether each letter is written. It is equally tiring for the examiner as well. So they think of us, they think of themselves, everyone. So what they do, if there are very complicated calculations, they either give MCQ or they add marks. Say, let's say if offline it was for 2 marks, maybe in online they'll give it for 3 marks. Because you are obviously taking more time to type it, right?
Ma'am, they are not good human beings.
No, the only not good human being was the one who got COVID. They genuinely, they do not want you to fall into any sort of trouble, and they do not want themselves to get caught up in all this jhamela. Because obviously, if you are doing something wrong, they have to get involved. So that's where no point of using the unfair means. It is better right now. It is not even December. You have December, January, February, March, 4 months, plus April, May, whenever you will have your exams. So there is ample amount of time. And trust me, it is not difficult. And it is the digital era. Even if you haven't started practicing typing, in general, it is time that you do, because further in life, it's everything soft copy. Everything will be digitalized. All the offices will become online. in some form. Even if you have to go and work, you will have to work on devices. There is hardly going to be any paperwork. So it is obviously necessary that you are used to this sort of interface. Right? So all they are doing is they are thinking of you. Always remember that there is also a very big upside, especially for IFOA, that you are getting to give an open book exam. Again, this upside, it is said openly that it is an open book exam, but you have to still give proper, you have to give a proper description of the place that you've taken your information from. It is an open book exam, not an open Google exam. Always remember that. No using Google at any cost. Never ever will you even try to open Google for anything. You have your material, you have your notes, you have Excel, R, any software you want to use. So many things at your disposal. Don't reach out to Google at all during your exam, because trust me, they are not stupid people. They will find out in some way or the other, at some point of time or the other, if you are using anything from the text. Especially this is for CB1, CB2 papers, especially because these two papers, they are so full of theory that you will end up using some parts from your notes or some parts, not your notes, obviously your personal notes. They don't matter. But if you are using something from, let's say, any reference book or from the institute's material itself, the entire referencing should be there. And what does the referencing mean? It should be para number, page number, chapter, and then acted material. Acted material, and when you will see your material, you will always see there is a year written on the bottom of each page. So most of yours, I think it must be 2019, I guess, 2019 2020 2021, so write the year as well. Now it might so happen that you do not have so much time, or you cannot understand which para it is. It's fine. Most important is this portion. This portion has to be there. Even if para number you want to skip in some questions, it is still fine. But these three things have to be there at any cost. Also, another thing, to make this faster, I would say, get a format ready before the exam where you have written para, comma, page, chapter, and the acted material with the year, whatever year you are using, and then just keep copy pasting it for each referencing. And when you copy paste it, you don't have to type in all these extra words again and again. You can simply insert the respective paras or the pages, etc. Another thing for the tables, always from tables, page, whatever, and then write the value. Even if you are using a normal distribution, even if you are planning to interpolate, write both the values and then write the interpolated answer. All right? Even for the complicated, for a little complicated formulas, let's say for EBCT. If for EBCT you are doing, then maybe you are referring to the formula from the table book, then please mention it. For CM2, CS2, maybe there are certain formulas which you also know inside, that had it not been in the tables, you would have never remembered it, right? You would have never memorized it. So just give the reference. They won't ever penalize you for giving any reference, because you are not doing anything wrong by looking at the formula from the tables. It is a legal thing that you are doing. But if you do it and you do not accept it on your paper, then you are at fault. So it is always better if any complicate, all of you know what paper you are studying, what formulas you might be using during your answers. So just keep a mental note regarding which formulas you might be wanting to give this reference as well. All right. Anything else, anyone? Everything is clear? Any other equation you all want me to type? Any other sort of equation, type of equation? Everything is good? So all of you just keep practicing. It is not hard. Trust me, I'm talking from a personal level. I'm not just a teacher, I'm a student as well. I have also given exams. I have seen people give exams, so don't worry at all. It will happen, and it will happen within the time limit. All right, if you panic, obviously you will lose out on time, but if you give your exam paper without these negative thoughts, then how will I complete it within the time limit? It's not going to happen, all right?